Ricardo Martínez, profesor de la Universidad de Granada y también pues colaborador habitual de algunos miembros del instituto, en particular de mí. Además, es conocido por muchos de vosotros porque lleva unos años que hace estancias en nuestro centro y por lo tanto, bueno, pues se le agradece porque ello pues contribuye a la mejora de la investigación aquí, pues por las sinergias que se pueden producir. El profesor Ricardo Martínez está en la Universidad de Granada, es profesor de título de la universidad, tiene diversas publicaciones en diversas revistas de impacto y ahora mismo creo que es el director de su departamento, si no me equivoco. Además, estuvo en la Universidad de Brown, en la Universidad de Málaga, en la Universidad de Salamanca, creo, o Valladolid o Salamanca, Ricardo.
En ninguna de las dos.
En León.
El León.
En la Universidad de León. Es decir, que además pues, ha estado en diversas universidades, con lo cual pues, conoce bien este mundo. Bueno, te cedo la palabra y muchas gracias por aceptar a impartir una charla online con nosotros.
Bueno, pues muchas gracias por la invitación a dar la charla y es lo menos que puedo hacer después de haberme sufrido allí durante tanto tiempo y lo que os queda en los años venideros. So what I'm going to present today is a joint work with my colleague and friend, with Juan, that if I'm not mistaken, he already presented a paper a few weeks ago. So the paper is about rationing. And by definition, we have a rationing situation because we don't have enough resources to honor all the demands or to cover all the needs. So that means that some individuals, by definition, will have to face sacrifices. So it's important to design allocation methods that implement certain principles of fairness, equity, if we want to call it like that, to respect those rationing methods. So, and that's what this paper is about. So, I'm going in the context of rationing problem within disabilities. I'm going to show you several ethical principles, and I'm going to identify the rationing methods that satisfies those ethical principles. So, what I'm going to do next is first I will introduce with more details what the problem is about. Then I will present you the model. I will move to some examples of rules that can be applied to this particular setting. Then I will tell you the ethical principles we are in particular interested in this paper. So I have to advance that the ethical principle in general in axiomatic theory are not, they don't pretend to be universal. So they don't pretend to be out of controversy. So those principles have to be taken as requirements that can be applied to different situations. So let me say it in a different way. Different problems and different situations may ask of different ethical principles. So that means that it's quite natural to criticize those principles. So they don't pretend to be universal. They don't mean to pretend to be applicable absolutely always, right? And that's important to have it in mind. So that's the sketch of the presentation. So let me start introducing a little bit more the problem. So rationing scarcity is a problem that is intrinsic in economics, but economics in a broad sense. So economics related with philosophy and with politics. So the adjudication of conflicting claims is a problem that is already documented in Aristotle's Ethics, in the Talmud, that as you know is the Jewish Bible, and even in the Book of Judgment. The Book of Judgment is written by Maimonides, that is a philosopher of the 12th century in Andalusia. So, from a formal perspective, the seminar paper is due to O'Neill. O'Neill was the first one in developing a formalized model to analyze this problem of adjudicating conflicting claims. And then there are like two or three more key papers in the literature, which are by Matrena an old man and by young. And Thompson wrote two different surveys. The paper in 2003, it was the first survey, and in 2015 is an update of that survey. So if you are interested in this literature, those two papers by William Thompson are the papers you should read. In the original problem, I mean, what we call the benchmark model, both the demand, the claims, and the resource to allocate are continuous. They are money. Or if they are not money, they can be identified with money, with something that is completely divisible. However, there are many situations in which the amount to divide, or the claims, or the amount to allocate cannot be divisible. You can think, for instance, on the ventilators, or the problem with the ventilator we have had during this pandemic. So we have several hospitals claiming for ventilators. We have to allocate the amount of ventilators that we have, that obviously is not enough to cover all the needs. And the ventilator is an indivisible item. So we cannot cut into two parts of ventilators. So it goes to one hospital, it goes to another one. But that's something completely indivisible. So in the analysis of adjudication of conflicted claims with indivisible units, there are like two main approaches. One approach is completely deterministic. So hospital A gets actually three ventilators, right, for instance. So that's, for instance, some of the key words on that approach are due to Moulin. Carmen and I had a paper on that. Frank also have worked on something related with discrete claims problems. And even Joaquin, Nati, Tere, and I are working on one of those models. So, and I actually think that the paper we are developing, it's the closest thing in the deterministic model to what I'm going to present today with our probabilistic approach. So those are the deterministic model, which if you say that hospital A gets three ventilators, you put three ventilators in that hospital. But now we are going to do something different, which is a probabilistic model. So why is it interesting to have a probabilistic, or why is it the case that in reality, even though we are allocating invisible units, we observe probabilistic approaches? So imagine that we have a divorce, and we have a property, we have a house, and we have to split this house, which is an indivisible item, between the couple, right? So if we sell the house, we have money and we can split it. If we don't sell the house, we have a trouble. And what in these circumstances some judges do is that they split the time of use of the property, right? So and that's something that is not a cut of the house, it's not two rooms for you and two rooms for you. So it's a splitting the use, which is something very close to a probabilistic model. And that is what this paper is about. So we are going to show you, I'm going to show you the model, but we are going to study the allocation of the adjudication of conflicted claims using a probabilistic approach. So, as I said at the beginning, we are going to apply what is called the axiomatic methodology. The axiomatic methodology does the following. So it says, let's discuss on the ethical principles we want to implement to solve the rationing problems. And then once we agree on those ethical principles, we will try to find the rules, the mathematical formulas that are compatible with those principles. But the discussion should not be about the rules. The discussion should be about the fairness or the stability we want to introduce in the solving of the rationing problems. In this sense, we are going to introduce in this paper two principles, compensation and sacrifice. I will be more precise on the meaning and the functioning of those principles during the presentation, but briefly, compensation means that we want to protect agents with small claims. And sacrifice is applied to those situations in which we want to protect individuals with large demands, right? And even though it may look something not so interesting, this idea of protecting individuals that are demanding a lot, and we try to convince you that there are circumstances in which It's not only that we want to do that, it's that in practice we are doing that, right? We will also introduce some requirements of monotonicity. Again, I will go through the details during the presentation. And we show in this paper that these principles lead to three particular rationing methods. Those methods are the probabilistic counterparts of the rules already, or the mechanisms suggested by Maimonides in the 12th century. We also find that some of the traditional rule, which is called the Talmud rule, cannot be extended to this probabilistic setting, right? Okay, if there is no question, I will go directly to the model. So a model is quite simple. So a problem is given by three elements, a set of agents, a vector of claims, and an amount to divide, which is called the endowment. So in for sake of simplicity, I'm not going to include the set of agents here in the models, but you know, it's assumed that it is there, right? So as long as you have the claims, you know how many individuals are involved in the problem. So we have a vector of claims. So C1 is what is claiming by agent one, C2 is what is claiming by by agent two, and so forth. And E is the amount to divide, it's called endowment. So because we are in a situation of rationing with indivisible units, we are going to assume that both the claims and the endowments are integers. So having a rationing situation means that the total demand, the sum of the demands, the sum of the claims, is larger than the amount we have to be divided, right? So just a bit of notation. So we are going to denote by calligraphic Dn, the set of all problems that involve individuals in N, by calligraphic D, the set of all possible rationing problems. The aggregate claim is going to be just the sum of all the claims. And the aggregate loss is going to be the difference between what is the aggregate claim minus the endowment we have. Right? Okay. So what is a deterministic allocation? A deterministic allocation is just a list, it's a vector of integer numbers that says which is the amount that is going to be received by each of the individuals. X1 is going to be the amount that is going to be received by individual one. X2 is going to be what it's going to get by individual two, and so on and so forth. So that allocation has to satisfy two requirements. First, for each individual, the amount that is received by that individual has to be positive, but it has to be lower than the claim. And it makes sense, because if we are in a rationing situation and we don't have enough to cover all the claims, it makes no sense that we give an individual more units than the amount of units this individual is demanding. And the second requirement is that we have to allocate the whole amount that we have. So we cannot give more than we have, than what we have, and we cannot allocate less than the endowment we have. So we are going to denote by capital X of CE, the set of all possible allocation for that problem, CE. I have a picture in the next slide to clarify this thing. So that is what a deterministic allocation is. But as I said, this paper is about applying a probabilistic approach to this problem. What is a probabilistic allocation? A probabilistic allocation is just a distribution of probabilities over the set of possible deterministic allocations. So it's a mapping such that give us the probability of each allocation or each deterministic allocation to happen, right? That's a probabilistic allocation. Capital theta of EC will denote the set of all possible the set of all possible probabilistic allocation for this problem. Let me try to clarify these two things with a picture. So let's assume that we have this example. We have two individuals. So everything that goes for individual one, it's on the vertical axis. Everything that refers to individual two, it's going to be on the, individual one, horizontal axis, individual two, vertical axis. So we have two individuals, one and two. They are claiming 4 and 7 units respectively. So this point here represents the claims. First individual is claiming 4 units, second individual is claiming 7 units. And we have 7 units to allocate. Obviously, we don't have enough to fully honor all the claimants. So if you check, this line represents all the possible allocation, discrete and continuous, or all the possible division of 7 units. Obviously, because we are in the context of indivisible units, not every point here is admissible. So only those crossing this gray grid are integers. So the set of deterministic allocation is what you, the orange point you have there. So this is, in this case, for instance, individual one is getting nothing and the 7 units goes to individual two. In this one, individual one is getting 1 unit, it's getting 1 unit, and individual two is getting 6 units, and so on and so forth. Why is it the case that this is not a deterministic allocation? Because in this allocation, that is a split of the 7 units we have, individual one will be getting 5 units, and that's more than he's demanding. So this is not a deterministic allocation. So all the possible deterministic allocations are just those 5 orange points there. So that's a deterministic allocation. And this is an example of probabilistic allocation. So a probabilistic allocation is just a specification of the probability of each possible deterministic allocation. So for instance, this distribution is what we call a probabilistic allocation, which means that all the allocations are possible, so none of them has zero probability to occur, and those are the probabilities that with which each of those allocations may happen. So that's for an example of a probabilistic allocation, and that's another example of a probabilistic allocation, in which we are saying that these allocations are not going to happen, no matter what, and then between these two, we are going to flip a coin, right? Though that is a probabilistic allocation. Okay, so if there is no question, so our goal will be to find or to determine for each particular problem a probabilistic allocation. If we do that, we will be solving the Klein's problem. So definitions, deterministic rule is a mapping that for each problem selects one and only one deterministic allocation. A probabilistic rule is a mapping rule that for each problem selects one, only one probabilistic allocation. So one of those purple and green allocations, probabilistic allocations. So a bit of notation. So rho of CE of X will be the probability with which the probabilistic rule selects the deterministic allocation X. So for instance, here, this allocation, rho of this allocation, will be 0.5. And for each A and I, we are going to denote by rho I of the problem the marginal distribution of rho with respect to I and I. In other words, so rho I of 3 of the problems, applied to 3, which will be the probability with which claimant I gets exactly 3 units, 4 units, or 5 units. So there may be many allocations in which individual one gets 3 units, right? So this denotes the probability with which this individual I gets exactly 3 units that may come from different allocations. So if there is no questions, I'm going to try to introduce some rules that can be applied to this setting. So the first rule, it's based on the constraint equal hours rule that is broadly used in the benchmark model. And it's reflecting the idea I told you at the beginning of Maimonides. So Maimonides says, there is the classical rule, which is proportional. So, but proportionality is something that we are not going to do, to study in this paper. At the end, I will show you why. Right? But this principle, this philosophical principle that inspired Maimonides says that no matter what the claims are, no matter the difference in needs, everybody should get exactly the same amount. In other words, the endowment must be equally split between the claimants. So imagine that we don't have indivisible units. Imagine that we are in a continuous wall. So that means that this line is representing from zero to C the set of all possible allocation when the endowment goes from zero to C. So for instance, if we have zero amount to divide, if we have zero units, then each of the individual gets zero. That's simple. So if we have just one unit to allocate, then we make an equal split, 0.5 for each of them. Again, assuming that we are in the continuous wall. If we have two units, we split one unit for each of the individual, no matter how big one of the claims is with respect to the other, right? That's the rule introduced by Maimonides. And we do exactly the same with all possible endowments. We make an equal split on the endowment. The problem is when we reach this point. So if we continue doing this equal split, we will be choosing something that is on this area. But this is out of the area of feasible allocation, because if for each stage we choose something here, individual one will be getting something which is larger than her claims. So if we reach this point, then because of feasibility, individual one is fully honored. He has received exactly what he's claiming. He cannot receive more. So the rest of the endowment, as the endowment increases, the rest goes to individual two, right? So that's the idea of Maimonides if you have a continuous amount of money. So we have to allocate the endowment uniformly among the individuals. What can we do if we have a probabilistic approach and we want to be as respectful as we can with this philosophical approach? Well, we do what you have there. So all the green points are the points in which the probability is positive. All the points that are not in green have zero probability to group. They are allocation, they are deterministic allocation, but we haven't drawn them because we don't give any probability to them. And as you notice, essentially, we are respecting exactly the same path. When the amount to divide is even, so we make an equal split, one half for each individual. And that will be determined. So we take that allocation with probability one. If the endowment is odd, then we cannot make an equal split. So we make the split as equal as possible in two senses. So we take the two closest allocation and we make both of them equally likely. So we assign 0.5 probability to each of those. That's what we call the probabilistic uniform awards rule that is trying to respect the idea introduced by Maimonides, but apply to this probabilistic setting. Here you have the definition more or less for the 2AN case. Obviously you can define these rules for more than two claimants. This is the definition, which is more elaborated. I'm not going to go through the details, but essentially it says that what I just mentioned. So you want to keep as close as possible to an equal split. If that is feasible because of the amount you have is a multiple of the number of agents, you do it. If not, you get which is closer in integers terms to an equal split, and you make all those equally likely. So another rule is the probabilistic losses rules. It's the dual idea of the rules I presented before. Instead of allocating the gains uniformly, what I'm going to do is allocate the losses uniformly. So if we have, like here we have, it was like four, oh, no, one, two, three, four, five, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, four, eight. So if we have 13 units, we can honor all the claims. So that will be the allocation. Imagine that we don't have 13 units and we only have 11 units. So how can we allocate those 11 units? If we have 11 and the total claim is 13, we have an aggregate loss of 2 units. So this rule says that, well, split that loss uniformly across individuals. So if we have just 11 units, individual one will lose one unit and individual two will lose one unit. So the allocation will be that one. And we do the same for all possible endowments. Once we reach this point, if we continue, one of the individuals will be getting a negative amount, which is not feasible. Then we move down. So that is the path that will be following the uniform losses rules if the state were completely divisible. Because we have to adapt this rule to our probabilistic setting, we do exactly the same trick as we did with the uniform awards rules. So we allocate the loss as uniformly as the setting allows us. If we are we have two individuals and the loss is even, then we make an equal split. And that is the allocation determined by the rules. If the loss is odd, then we choose the closest possible allocations and we make them equally like, right? And we believe that this is the closest thing in our setting that we can be to the idea of the uniform loss probability. It's the uniform loss rule. So again, here you have the formal definition. I mean, if you don't need it, I'm not going to go through the details, but that's the idea. So you try to be as close to uniformly as possible in terms of the losses. So the next rule I want to show you is the rule that was introduced or was documented in the Talmud. And it is called, for the 2A in case, it's called the concede and divide rules. And actually, so examples showing how to divide an amount in this kind of situation. And what it happens is that there is a rule with formulas that coincide exactly, apply to those particular cases you have in the Talmud, with the allocation that is proposed by the Gerwitz Bible, right? That's why it's called the Talmud rule. So this rule is just a kind of convex combination between the constraint equal awards and the constraint equal losses. So it starts as the constraint equal awards from here, and it starts as the constraint equal losses here. And then for this range of endowments, it's moved up, right? Again, it's just the convex combination of the two rules I have presented before. How can we adapt this rule to our probabilistic setting? Doing exactly the same trick. So when we have something that is even, we take it. When we have something that is odd, we flip a coin with equal probability among those allocations that are closest to the ideal equal spread, right? Okay, there are many other rules. So for instance, you can take the proportional rule and then taking the points which are closer to the continuous thing, and then playing with those probabilities and so on. Even these rules that I have presented here can be easily generalized because, for instance, in this setting, we have assumed that this allocation and this allocation are equally likely. But that's the way we have defined this rule. One may think that it is possible to even give different probabilities to these two allocations. For instance, related with something else. That's different ways of generalizing these rules we are using here. So those are just three examples of rules. I have presented those because at the end that's going to be the rules we characterize in this paper. But there are many other possibilities. So as I said at the beginning, so rationing is about imposing ethical principles. And that's what I'm going to do next. So I'm going to tell you the ethical principles or the formalization of the ethical principle we are interested in this paper, with the aim that they are suitable for certain situations. That doesn't mean, as I said at the beginning, they are lack of the critique. They can be criticized and they don't pretend to be applied to every single rational situation we may have, right? But we believe that they make sense and they are very based on some properties that have a lot of tradition in the continuous model. So before starting, let me introduce something that I'm sure you know very well, that is the definition of stochastic domination. We say that the distribution of individual I, theta I, stochastically dominates the distribution of individual I, mu I, if and only if the probability of getting under theta A is always a certain amount, A is always greater than the probability of getting under mu the same amount, right? So, and that definition is going to be very useful in our probabilistic context. So let's go to the principle I mentioned at the beginning. So Klein's monotonicity. Klein's monotonicity says that if an individual increases her claim, it makes no sense that he will receive less than he was receiving originally. So if individual I increases her claim, at least he should be as good as he was in originally. So in other words, if the claim increases, the allocation of individual I will stochastically dominate in the new problem the allocation in the original problem, right? So again, Klein's monotonicity means that if the claim of an individual increases, the allocation of this individual will stochastically dominate the allocation of this individual in the with the reduced claim. Link-claim endowment monotonicity, that's a property we took from the benchmark model, says the following. So imagine that we have an individual, and the individual of the claim of this individual and the amount to allocate, both of them increases by the same, exactly the same amount d. So claim of individual I increases by d, the endowment also increases by d. It makes sense that the allocation of the of this individual I is going to increase. But what the link-less endowment monotonicity says is that there is an upper bound of that possible increase. So what this property says is that if we increase this by the same amount, both the endowment and the claim of an individual, then at most the allocation of that individual will increase by that same amount d. So there may be an increase, but it will be upper bounded. So now about the key properties we use in this paper. So let's start with an example. So imagine that you have 15 units to allocate and you have four individuals. Individual one is claiming two, individual two is claiming three, and individual four and five are claiming 40 and 50 respectively. Obviously, we have a rationing situation because the 15 units we have are not enough to satisfy all their claims. But if we look at carefully this rationing situation, we have the situation because the claim of individual three and the claims of individuals three and four, right? So somehow the claims of the first two individuals are very small. They are so small that they are not responsible for having such a situation. What this property says is that small claimants should be excluded from rationing. Small claimants should get exactly what they are demanding. That's what the next property is about, excluding small claimants from the rationing and giving them the whole demand they are claiming. So, problem. How do we decide that a claimant is a small claimant? And that's what the property is about. So if we look at the this example here, so we say that individual one is not responsible for having a rationing situation because if everybody else were claiming at most what this first individual is claiming, so if everybody were claiming these two units, then with the endowment we have, we will have enough to cover all the claims. So if there is a rationing situation, it's not because of the individual two. Because if everybody were claiming what this individual is claiming at most, then with the endowment we have, that will be enough. So individual one in this sense is a small individual. Is not responsible from the rationing from the existence of the rationing problem, and therefore it should be excluded for rationing. Individual one in this problem should get exactly the two units this individual is claiming, and the same applies to individual three. So, from a probabilistic perspective, what this property says is that in that cases, the probability of an allocation in which individual two is not getting, individual one is not getting exactly the 2 units he's claiming is equal to 0. So we have to guarantee that individual one and individual two, because they are small claimants using the approach I just mentioned, should get in any allocation that has positive probability to occur, should get exactly individual one should get 2 units and individual three, so and individual two should get exactly the 3 units. Right? So in other words, the mass of one of the probability has to be allocated among all the allocation in which individual one and two, or individual in this case, the individual I, which is in the situation I mentioned before, is getting exactly per cup. So that's what we call conditional compensation. There is the dual idea of conditional sacrifice. So in conditional compensation, we want to determine when an individual is claiming such a little that he should be exempted from the responsibility of Russia. Conditional sacrifice is the dual idea. And it says, there are cases in which those small claimants, and we will see what a small claimant is, but a small claimant should get nothing, which is exactly the opposite. So things, and this is, it makes look something not very fair, but it's what we do in practice when the demands are not money, when the demands are fundamental needs. For instance, many healthcare systems are based on this idea of conditional sacrifice or equal sacrifice. So imagine that you have two individuals that need two medical treatments. One individual needs a pill, and another individual gets a chemotherapy treatment, whose cost is 3,000 euros. And then the pill for the first individual is just 3 euros. So usually we don't make a proportional split of the budget we have for the healthcare systems. So what happens is that it's very likely that the individuals with a small claim that just need 3 euros for a pill is going to pay those 3 euros. And then we devote all the possible endowment we have to reduce the contribution of the individuals who need a more serious medical treatment, right? So that's the idea behind the property of conditional sacrifice. So there are circumstances in which, when the claim is very small, especially when the claim represents a fundamental need, like the situation I mentioned before, it's better to devote all the possible effort to individuals with a huge needs, right? So what this property says is the following. So if the difference in terms of the sacrifice is not very much, then small individuals should get nothing. And everything should go to individuals with large needs. It's the dual idea of conditional compensation. In conditional compensation, we determine when a small individual is getting everything, because we want to favor them. In conditional sacrifice, we determine when small individuals don't get anything, because we want to prioritize individuals with larger needs. So both conditional compensation and conditional sacrifice. So it's called compensation because in the first property, you are giving, right? And it's called sacrifice because in the second property, those are small individuals, those who are facing a complete sacrifice. They are not getting anything. It's called conditional because that happens only in several circumstances. When I declare a small with respect to the gains or a small with respect to the losses. But they are like two extreme situations because for those particular individuals, say that you get everything or you don't get nothing. The next two properties deals with intermediate situations. So we call them sewer compensation and sewer sacrifice. So let me start with the same example as we have before. So we have 15 units and we have 4 claimants that are demanding 2 units, 3, 40, and 50 units. So sewer compensation is about which is the minimum quantity we can guarantee to each individual. So it's like a minimum salary, if you want to put it like that. So which is the minimum amount that no matter what should be guaranteed to each possible, to each claimant. Obviously, this minimum amount will be related with the rest of the elements of the problem, the total demand, the endowment, the number of individuals, whatever. But what is what we should give for granted to each possible individual? There should be some minimum amount that every individual should have granted. So sure compensation says that at least, and here you have it, at least any individual should get either the division, the split, or the equal split of the endowment, so 1/10 of the total endowment, or 1/10 of his claim, whatever is minimum, right? So in this particular, for this particular problem, for instance, that will mean that X1, the allocation of X1 has to be positive. The allocation of X2 has to be positive, but that's not saying anything at all, because by definition, they have to be positive. Individual 3 should get at least 3 units, and individual 4 should get, if this property is satisfied, at least 3 units. So as you can check, if this has to be satisfied, we are just allocating the first 6 units. The other amount of units, till 15, that is the amount we have, can be allocated in any way you want. But at least we have to guarantee to individuals 3 and 4 that they should get at least 3 units, right? That's what sure compensation is which is the minimum amount we can guarantee to all individuals. In addition to that, that minimum amount, which you may think that is quite arbitrary, so why is the case that we put this minimal amount and no any other thing? Well, first, it makes sense, essentially, because it's almost an equal split. And the second is that is the maximal minimum amount in the following sense. So if you try to put an upper bound, so that's minimal granted, that is an epsilon higher than the amount we have here, then you get allocation that are not feasible with the definition of allocation. So you get an impossibility. If you have something that is an epsilon smaller, you can even increase this minimum granted and still get feasibility. So in that sense, this lower bound is maximum. So sure sacrifice is exactly the same. Instead of which is the minimum amount, minimum award we can guarantee, here what we are dealing is with which is the maximal sacrifice and the individual we have to face, right? And again, it's the dual idea. So we say that the maximum sacrifice should be the smallest between these two numbers, the nth part of the aggregate loss or the nth part of the claim. So if we apply this property to the problem we had before, then we are saying that the loss, that is, 2 units, individual 1 is claiming minus X1, the amount that we are going to give them has to be positive. 3 minus X2, that's for individual 2, has to be positive, and the same for the rest. And here you can check, sure sacrifice is not imposing anything at all, because this means that individual 1 has to get something smaller than 2. This means that individual 2 has to get something smaller than 3. Individual 3 has to get something smaller than 40, and in the other 4, if you move this X4 to the other side of the inequality, has to get something smaller than 50. But that had to happen just because of the definition of deterministic allocation, right? So individual, in this, for this particular case, sure sacrifice is not imposing anything. Well, sure compensation is bounded the set of allocation that in the probabilistic setting may have positive probability to happen. So the next property, sorry, there is a mistake here, it shouldn't be monotonicity. The next property is what we call bilateral evenness. So bilateral evenness says the following. So imagine that we have reached a situation in which we cannot disentangle between those very, very, very close allocation because of the nature of the problem we are dealing with. So we have discarded many allocation, but we're in a situation in which we cannot go forward, right? This is like the case of the Solomon's dilemma. So we have, if you remember, these two mother claiming for a baby, and the baby is, let's assume that the baby is an indivisible unit, so we cannot cut the baby in half. So what can we do? So if we don't want to cut the baby in half, we can give the baby to one mother, we can give the baby to Marvin. And if everything else is discarded, and we don't have any way to solve this problem, so one possibility is just to flip a coin with equal probability, and then allocate the baby to the mother according to the result of the flip. Right? That's what the bilateral illness says. So if you just have two individuals, and you have an allocation that differs just in one unit, which is actually the size of the indivisibility, those two allocations should have the same probability to happen. I repeat it. Just for the case of two claimants, if you have three claimants, you don't have any restriction at all. That's applied only if you have a problem with two claimants. If you have 40 claimants, we don't impose any restriction. That property is backwardly satisfied. So you have a problem with just two individuals, and you are in a situation in which you have five units, and the only allocation that have positive probability to Goulart 2-3 on 3-2, and you have no other way to disentangle between those two, then those two are feasible, and they should happen with the same probability. It's just flipping a coin. The next property we consider is consistency. Consistency is a property with a lot of tradition in rationing. So let me try to introduce how we adapt it. Well, not we, because we took it from a paper by Boulet to the probabilistic setting. So consistency is as the following. So generally speaking, it says that the way you solve problems with a lot of individuals should be related with the way you solve problems with a smaller group of individuals. So imagine that you have a certain amount of claimants, you solve the problem, and you give each of those claimants the amount according to the method. And then one of those claimants leaves the room. So there's a claimant that guessed the amount he received, and with that amount, leaves the room. And imagine that we face the problem of, what if we allocate among the rest of the individuals remaining in the room? What if we solve again the problem, allocating among themselves the amount they have? Right? I repeat, we solve the problem with n individuals, one individual leaves the room, and then we have n minus one individuals still in the room. If we solve the problem of allocating everything but what it was assigned to the individual leaving the room among those two, consistency says that you should get exactly the same as before. In other words, imagine that the university allocates money among the departments, right? So the university says, I have like 30 people, in another research institute, I have 15 people. And so I have a list of all the researchers in Universidad Miguel Hernández, and then I solve the problem, and instead of sending the money to each of individuals, I send the money to the research institute, right? So Theo received 50,000 euros, which is the amount that should be collectively assigned to individuals to the research institute. That is award to individual, to its award to members of CEO. So, and now CEO decides, what if I apply the same rule the university has applied to allocate among ourselves the 50 euros we have been awarded? Consistency says that, well, if you apply the same rule, no matter if the money goes directly to the researcher or the money goes to CEO and from CEO to the researchers, if you apply the same rule, at the end, the allocation should be exactly the same. That's what consistency is about, right? So in probabilistic terms, it says that those two steps are stochastically independent, right? So if you don't have a question, what is it? Oh, so you don't have, I'm going to go very quickly to the results. So those are the characterization results we get for a trying case. That says that they have to be read in the following way. If you want a probabilistic rule that satisfies conditional credit monotonicity, conditional compensation, and bilateral ignorance, if you do want a rationing method that is compatible with those ethical principles, then you have to use the uniform, the probabilistic uniform awards rule I showed you before. If you don't use that property, it means that one of those three principles will be violated. Right? That's what the theorem is about. The second theory is also a characterization of the probabilistic uniform losses rule. So if you want link-length endowment monotonicity, conditional sacrifice, and bilateral evenness, if you want the rationing method to satisfy those three principles, you have to use the probabilistic uniform losses rules. No way to do it in another way, in another matter, right? And the same for the concite and divide rule. So if you want, if you impose sure sacrifice, sure compensation, and bilateral illness, you have to use the concite and divide rules. As you can check, if you both, this theorem is saying that if you want these three combinations of properties, not only you have to use that, you cannot use something based on the proportionality. If you use something based on the proportionality, some of those properties will be violated. So that was for the two-agent case, when we just have two individuals. So what if we have the general case, when we don't have any restriction, we have any number of individuals we want. So we also have a characterization for that case. And the characterization says that if we impose credit monotonicity, conditional compensation, bilateral evenness and consistency, then we end up in the probabilistic uniform loss rules. And the same, the dual result for the probabilistic uniform loss rules. If we require link claim endowment monotonicity, conditional sacrifice, bilateral evenness and consistency, we are obliged to use the probabilistic uniform losses. So one thing that was surprising for us is that if we try to extend to the general case the characterization of the concite and divide, we are not successful. No, we are not successful in the sense that we cannot extend the result. We are not successful in the sense that if we want to keep the three properties that characterize the concite and divide rules and add inconsistency, as we have done in these two results, to extend from the two-agent case to the general case, we prove there is no rule that satisfies those four threats. So we have to get rid of one of those principles because they are not compatible. Comparing the benchmark model where everything is continuous with the probabilistic model, we find out that we are getting the counterpart's characterization of the constraint equal awards rule and the constraint equal losses rules. So it's not, the comparison is not straightforward because they are not exactly the same rules, the same properties in the characterization, but they can be the characterization in the benchmark model can be extended because those rules are also satisfied by the constraint equal losses and the constraint equal awards rules. So what is the difference? The difference is that in the benchmark model, there is a consistent extension of the concite and divide rule. And that consistent extension is the rule in the term model. In the probabilistic models, we prove that not only the Talmud is not a consistent extension in this probabilistic model of the concite and divide, we prove there does not exist such a consistent extension.
Bueno, la cuestión hay algunas, en primer lugar el enfoque me parece muy interesante y veo que bueno que lo que sucede que es que al final las propiedades lo que cargan es sobre las probabilidades que se le asignan a las asignaciones factibles, ¿no? Entonces, bueno, esto es una cosa que me ha venido a la mente, es a lo mejor si le damos igual probabilidad a todas las asignaciones factibles dentro del retículo, tendríamos una cosa cercana a la proporcional. O sea, en vez de utilizar nada más que los caminos, o sea, no lo sé, porque tampoco, esto ha sido a bote pronto, ¿no? Es decir, todos los puntos que son, no sé si los factibles o los que sean eficientes, todos los que sean, que lo distribuyan todo de todas las maneras posibles dentro de la factibilidad, y le asignamos la misma probabilidad. Y todos son equiprobables. ¿Eso podría acercarse a lo que sería la proporcional?
No se acerca, no se acerca a la
¿No?
proporcional, no se acerca a la proporcional. Porque de hecho, la propiedad está de Clay's monotonicity, es decir,
Sí.
si aumento mi claim, yo no puedo estar peor que lo que estaba anteriormente.
Sí.
Está trasladado a un contexto probabilístico, es decir, que con el claim aumentado, mi distribución tiene que dominar estocásticamente la distribución del claim
Sí,
reducido.
sí.
Vale. Esta propiedad limita bastante el conjunto de asignaciones que te pueden tener probabilidad positiva. ¿De acuerdo? Entonces, cuando tú empiezas de un punto y aumentas el claim, hay muchas cosas que ya te dicen esto no puede tener probabilidad positiva. Entonces, por eso te estoy diciendo que todos con igual probabilidad no te acerca a la proporción y no te acerca a nada, de hecho. ¿De
Nada,
acuerdo?
¿no?
No, porque viola propiedades. Clay's monotonicity, que es una propiedad que normalmente en el modelo normal pues no está diciendo mucho y no es muy limitante. Aquí limita el path este bastante, ¿no? Porque ya te digo, nosotros, de hecho, para caracterizar las reglas, tenemos varios resultados donde relajamos alguna de las propiedades, quitamos propiedades, ¿no? Y no conseguimos caracterizaciones completas, pero sí sabemos cuál es el impacto de alguna de esas propiedades. Tenemos digamos, el resultado en una dirección del teorema. Y Clay's monotonicity limita bastante.
Bueno, no sé si hay más gente que tenga otras cuestiones. Luego es porque, bueno, las propiedades está claro que limitan el conjunto de asignaciones que pueden tener probabilidad positiva, ¿no? Porque restringe el conjunto y luego que la suma sea uno y excluye otras. Entonces esas probabilidades son determinadas exógenamente por el central planner,
No, son
¿no?
determinadas endógenamente por la regla.
Por la regla.
A ver, lo que la regla dice es, la regla te da las probabilidades las asignaciones que tienen probabilidad positiva y cuál es cada una de esas probabilidades, ¿de acuerdo? Por ejemplo, la Probabilistic Uniform Awards Rule lo que dice es que todo lo que esté cerca del equal split es probable, tiene probabilidad positiva y tiene la misma probabilidad.
Probabilidad.
Entonces, te la da. Pero si quitas alguna propiedad, ¿de acuerdo? Lo que tienes son reglas que te limitan el conjunto de cosas que pueden ocurrir, pero solamente pero con distintas probabilidades. Pero son endógenas. Es decir, digamos que tendrías familias de reglas, que a lo mejor en lugar de ser las dos cosas que están más cerca, la misma probabilidad, pues tienen distintas probabilidades, las que sean. Esto, por ejemplo, si quitas bilateral ifness de nuestro resultado, pues tienes esto. Propiedades parecido al camino de la CEA, pero las asignaciones no tienen la misma probabilidad. Pues una puede tener 0,7 y la otra 0,2. O incluso ser deterministas, una tener probabilidad 1 y la otra probabilidad 0.
Vale. Bueno, por mí yo ya.
Pero lo que quiero decir es que el modelo probabilístico, y por eso lo de la imposibilidad del Talmud, no es una adaptación tan inmediata del modelo normal, que es diferente en cuanto a planteamiento, es diferente en cuanto a propiedades y que los resultados no son los mismos. De hecho, los referís, al menos uno de los referís, lo que nos decía era que precisamente lo que más le gustaba era el resultado de imposibilidad, ¿sabes? De decir, oye, mira, yo estaba leyendo el paper y me parecía todo muy evidente lo que se estaba extendiendo hasta que llega el resultado de imposibilidad. Entonces, pues hay referís que le gustan los resultados de imposibilidad. Joaquín, hay otros que no les gustan los resultados de imposibilidad, ¿verdad?
No, no, ya lo sé. No, pero también hay otra curiosidad que me viene, bueno, perdonad los demás, ¿no? Pero bueno, ¿habéis probado algún tipo de self-duality o algo así? Porque claro, bueno, ya sabemos que la Talmud es y entonces, ¿algún tipo de dualidad que nos permita conectar la que distribuye, bueno, las pruebas uniformemente en la Uniformity Awards y la Uniformity Losses? ¿Alguna dualidad entre esas? Porque las propiedades parece que sean, vamos a ver, en el modelo clásico, las propiedades son, estas propiedades pueden ser duales, ¿no? Y aquí con las probabilidades también se puede generar ese tipo de dualidad.
La dualidad es un poco más tricky en este modelo. Porque como tienes probabilidades, ¿de acuerdo? El problema es que, gráficamente hablando, la dualidad es que el camino desde abajo es igual que el camino desde los superiores.
Exactamente.
Pero ojo, por ejemplo, la consider la CA no es dual, la igual la C no es dual, pero la consider and divide sí es dual, ¿no? ¿no? Pero cuando tú estás en el continuo es muy fácil. Pero cuando tú estás en un discreto, a lo mejor la rotura de lo que vas por debajo no coincide con la rotura de cuando vas por arriba. Y eso te rompe la autodualidad.
Y la dualidad en general, que
Y en
por ejemplo,
general,
una que sea una relación una de la
lo mismo
otra,
pasa con
una
la
propiedad igual de
computacional.
la otra,
¿Perdona?
o que las propiedades sean unas duales de las otras o las reglas unas duales de las otras, como sucede con la CA y
Sí,
la CEL y con la.
el concepto de dualidad existe. De hecho, las caracterizaciones que hacemos de la Uniform Losses son por dualidad.
Ah, vale.
Lo que no es fácil es la autodualidad como propiedad.
Dualidad. Vale.
La probabilidad es autodual en el modelo continuo. La proporcional es autodual en el modelo continuo. En el probabilístico no, porque si tú haces la línea de la proporcional, los redondeos por arriba pueden no ser lo mismo que los redondeos por debajo.
Vale.
Y entonces ya violas la autodualidad.
Bueno, pues ya está, ¿no? De nuevo, bueno, felicitarte por el trabajo. La verdad es que también el trabajo de imposibilidad, el teorema de imposibilidad, a mí también me ha gustado mucho. Eso de que añadiendo así, porque normalmente esa regla es la que más, cuando la extiendes, todo funciona bastante bien. Y en este caso, pues, se queda en el vacío, ¿no? En ninguna regla. Y eso
Bueno,
yo creo que está muy
es
bien.
decir, que aquí tuvimos la suerte de que la propiedad de consistencia la había hecho Hervé y no la hicimos nosotros, ¿no? Porque justificar la consistencia diciendo la ha hecho Moulin es más fácil que justificar la consistencia nosotros.
Vale, gracias. Yo ya no tengo más dudas.
Muchas gracias a vosotros y nos vemos.
Muchas
Bueno,
gracias.
Ricardo,
Hasta
hasta
luego.
luego.